Welcome to Brighton Festival 2019. Our very exciting show is going to start with something that is semi-serious, but only semi, and we'll find out about it in a minute. The Birth of Death. And with me are Joanne and Yael, actor and director. Let's start with you, Joanne. Tell me a little bit about the show.
The show began after the death of my mum, and I had a really powerful experience with that. It gave me gifts as well as, you know, the pain and the grief, and I wanted to share it bit by bit. It stayed with me. I need to make something with this. It was very special to be at her death, and so I started thinking who is with other people when they die, and somehow I knew what to do, and I felt really lucky about that. So I came to Brighton and started training to be an end-of-life doula.
So what is an end-of-life doula? I obviously heard of a doula, but what is an end-of-life doula?
So there's an amazing company called Living Well, Dying Well, based in Sussex, and what they do is they teach people to be present, essentially, to support the person who is dying with just with the state of presence. But also they teach you how to do the practical things like the preparation, the paperwork, support the family. How can the family be there? Who does a dying person want to have with them?
Okay. And the show itself, does it bring element of that?
It's certainly influenced. It's influenced how I see death, all the research that I've done and research trips around India, looking at ritual theatre, and it's all kind of fed in to support the show.
Okay. Yael, you directed the show. Mm-hmm. I have to say, when I read the description, I was in tears immediately. You know, first sentence and I was gone. But I understand that the show is not just sad, or it has element of comedy as well. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. I think that death is a big taboo and people are really afraid to talk about it because nobody knows. Nobody knows what happens after death. Nobody called us, nobody told us, there's no emails, there's no SMSs, we just have no idea. So I think, yeah, I mean, it's something so mysterious, and so people prefer not to talk about it. And I think in England, maybe especially, it's a big taboo and the rituals are very, very small. I mean, you just go, you put someone in the grave and then, you know, and you don't know what to do with it. And I think that it was super interesting when Joanne offered me to direct the show, to think about how can we talk about it with other people, how can we see it in different ways, how can we laugh about it as well as cry about it, and to find different way to access this theme, which I think we're all in the same boat about it. So I think Joanne is extremely talented in opening the audience's heart. She's a bit of a transformative shaman or something. Like, she really has this amazing way of sharing things and speaking with people in a very delicate, intelligent, I was thinking about it, sensible and sensitive at the same time. These two words that I often confused between, but it's both of them. So I think that we just try to make an experience that can open people's hearts and then touch them to maybe see this theme in different ways.
Right. And rather symbolically and very quickly, you had a near-death experience yourself when rehearsing for this show, is that right? Do you want to tell me quickly about that? That sounded pretty awful.
So these teeth aren't my real teeth. I hate these teeth, they're plastic. We had a bicycle accident. Yael was going down the hill from Brighton train station, and I imagined that the truck, articulated lorry, was moving slightly quicker than it was towards her, panicked. Then I thought it was moving towards me, panicked, put my brakes on, went over the handlebars, and then waited to call Yael and tell her, I've had an accident.
Right.
She's terrified of blood. I had to come and see my mouth.
I mean, do you think that in some way that's affected you, the way you're performing?
Yeah, it definitely has. It was a very powerful experience to have my face completely transformed and, you know, realise what I have. And yeah, I'm facing my own mortality probably for the first real time.
Okay.
Definitely.
Okay, well, I'm glad you're fine now. Yael, just tell us where and when.
Okay, so it's on the 15th of May at 6 p.m. at the Warren's Hat. And there's lots of places, lots of room for many people, so all of Brighton can basically come to see the show.
Okay.
And we are waiting for you, 6 p.m., 15th of May, The Birth of Death.
Thank you very much both for coming.
Thank you.
Now, latest TV's Bill Smith has been around for a long time. Someone else has been around for a long time. In fact, was the director of the festival for 12 years, since 1984. And that's Gavin Henderson. And here's Bill talking to Gavin.
One of the things I'm terribly proud of, really, is the children's parade. I gave birth to it, really, and it was my idea originally. 1985 was the first children's parade. And it was that year, there was a whole theme around circus and clowns and commedia dell'arte. And I thought it'd be lovely to have a kind of parade of the circus comes to town. And that grew into something with the schools, and it became something more than simply a circus parade. And the schools all loved it, and they were competing with each other to get into this parade, really. I mean, it wasn't as huge as it's become now. And then the following year, people, instead of saying, are we going to do something, they said, when is the children's parade going to be? And it took root. I mean, that's...
You also sort of started the fringe a bit, too.
We did. We created an umbrella programme. Which is wonderful, the way it's. I always hoped that it would take off in an independent way, and it has. It's become the Brighton Fringe is, I mean, it's nothing like as big as the Edinburgh Fringe yet, but it's certainly the most important fringe festival in England, shall we say. And you know, I run a drama school now, the Royal Central School of Speech and Drama, and a lot of our people talk now about taking a show to the Brighton Fringe. How can we get into the Brighton Fringe? It's got that sort of status, really. The other thing is that the overall structure of the festival I changed completely. It was originally a 10-day festival primarily of classical music, and I wanted to bring in theatre and dance and actually also develop the visual arts, because the open house programme really came in through at that time. And so we expanded it to a structure of 3 weeks and four weekends, and that's remained, that's how it is. So I'm delighted that it's still so deeply rooted, and I think the city as a whole takes it to itself. I think it's very proud of its festival.
How many years did you do?
I was here for 12 years.
12 years, what years were they? Can you remember?
Yes, I arrived in 1984. And went through to 1994-95.
I remember some wild nights in those tents up at the station with Christine and yourself.
Yes.
And Tony Miller and people.
Yes, yes.
Do you remember them?
Of course I do. There was a sort of madness about the festival in those days. I think it... There were more actual Brighton people taking part in it, shall we say. As it's grown to be a truly international festival, the real pressure is to how to bring in companies from far and wide, and especially companies that aren't necessarily going to go to London. So people will come from London to see shows in the Brighton Festival.
I think there's a grassroots festival taking off, Brighton Grassroots Festival, January next year.
So. Is there?
Yeah, I believe there is.
Right, well, I look forward
to
that.
Welcome that.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah, thank you very much, Gavin,
okay.
For your memories of Brighton Festival.
Thank you.
Hi, we're at the Warren at Brighton Fringe. Brighton, 250,000 people, but a million dreams, and they're all on the fringe. And Jade Dragon, she sounds like a pop star. She's going to see them all. How are you going to do it, Jade?
It's going to be a marathon over the next couple of weeks. Art and culture, theater, dance, film. I'm taking it all in, and I'm very happy to come back to you and tell you all about it.
When? When's the show on?
Every day. Every day at our show.
Yeah.
Our show.
Yeah.
8:30 every day, latest TV.
That's it, Channel 7. Watch.
Join me after the break when we'll be introduced to Janet and Doe. You'll see what I mean later. And Bill Smith will talk to Jade Dragon about the festival highlights. Welcome back. Festival patron Jade Dragon is here to talk with Bill about what she recommends to see in the festival.
On Brighton Festival for us, all through this festival. So Jade, what things do you recommend? Go.
I would recommend, I'm quite excited about the upcoming show, Trap Town, which is a fusion of cinema and choreography. And it's been commissioned for the Brighton Festival, so it's an original piece. So it's definitely one to see here. And it's the favorite choreography team of the festival director, Rokia Traore. So that's a really exciting one coming up.
Where's it on?
That's on at the Brighton Dome, okay, as part of the Brighton Festival.
So that's one to go and another to
one
go?
One to go. If you have kids, I would say I'm excited about Return to the Forbidden Planet at the Little Brighton Theatre and The Adventures of the Baron Munchausen, which is a super film, so it'll be really interesting to see how they adapt that into a kids' show at the Brighton Fringe.
So that's go two, and go three?
Go three would be, Nina Cherry in concert. I mean, that's a pretty cool one. Just throw that in. Oh, and the photography exhibition, quite heart-hitting, by King Masase from Malia.
What about latest TV presenters? Don't you think you should go and see maybe one of them?
Yeah, or come see us on the Brighton Pier, probably once a week during the festival.
And then Guy Lloyd.
Oh, and Guy Lloyd, yeah, okay, the one-person shows. Thanks for reminding me. I was telling you I was excited about this. Guy Lloyd, Radio Blah Blah, one-man show, and he's a latest TV presenter. And then there's this other, Rebecca Pershagen. She's coming on my podcast series, The Culture Kitchen, that I do with Karen Kemp. And she's doing a one-woman show called Daddy Issues.
So, Jade, we know the ones that you want to go to, but how did you get to go to anything in Brighton Festival? How did you get involved?
Well, when I moved here, I saw there was a festival happening and, of course, got some tickets to see some shows, and I thought, this is such a great thing. There's the Edinburgh Festival and the Edinburgh Fringe, which people, you know, do pilgrimages annually to go and attend all the shows there to see talent before it goes to the rest of the world. And I felt really excited to be in Brighton and see that there was something like that happening here. And I happened to meet a festival patron, and we talked a bit about what was involved in being a patron and what it was like and how it had enriched her life living here in Brighton. And she brought me along to a patron's event, and I met so many interesting people. Being new to the city, I really didn't know that many people. So I thought, this is fantastic. I can support the arts, meet kindred spirits, and hopefully maybe have a hand in introducing some artists to the festival at some point too.
So cool networking, I think, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It's called authentic networking, when you actually believe in what you're doing. Yeah.
Yeah. And have you enjoyed it? How long have you been doing it? About a year or two now, is it?
Yeah, it's been a year.
A year.
Yeah. So I've really enjoyed it.
A newbie.
I am a newbie. This is my first festival season as a patron, and I feel there's a responsibility. I've got to see a lot of rehearsals. I've got to do a lot of reviews, and it's really exciting to attend a festival that way, with that intention.
Jade will be back to Yael in the studio.
Thank you, Bill and Jade. And now, you'll be very surprised to see what can be done with dough.
With me is Helen Ainsworth, who's come to the studio to talk to us about an unusual fringe show. Hello, Helen.
Hello.
Tell me all about it. It's called Janet.
It's called Janet, yes. And the unusual thing about it is all the characters are played by objects. Objects and a lump of dough,
right,
which is Janet.
And do you dress as you are?
Yes, I dress as I am, but I have a mask as well. And the whole show is encased with... under the pretense of a cooking demonstration. So with the masked character presents the show and presents the dough and the objects as objects that you would work with.
Okay.
But then as the show develops, we find that they have a life of their own and characters of their own.
So it's not a real cooking demonstration, it's actually a story.
It's a story, yes.
And what's
yes.
the story in a nutshell?
In a nutshell, it's the life of Janet. So we see Janet from conception, right from the beginning, right through to her rather tragic end. I don't want to spoil it, but she's a lump of dough, bread dough. And her fight is a fight against her destiny, against going to the oven. She doesn't want to go to the oven.
Okay, and just to clarify, it isn't a show for children, right?
No, over 16s.
Right, yeah. Because there is a lot of
There's a lot of life experience right. along the way that Janet has, a lot of experiences with a couple of baguettes and a rolling pin.
Right.
And, of course, her conception is we also see on stage.
Okay,
so
right.
I wouldn't want younger children.
And in a minute we'll see you demonstrating a bit of it, but I've already seen a little bit of it, and it's amazing actually how the dough comes to life. What interests me is how did you think about that kind of thing?
That was really a coincidence. I spent a lot of time with my children playing in the kitchen, as you do, and a lot of attempts to make pizza, which didn't go so well, so we ended up playing with the dough.
Right.
And really the idea grew from there, that I think it could have a lot of life, and we kept seeing faces that we didn't create in the dough, and we developed that eventually in the rehearsal room, myself and the director, John Moat.
Okay, so just before you show us how Janet, you know, works, where and when is the show?
So the show will be happening in two venues between the 2nd and the 10th of May, so right early on in the Fringe, and I'll be at the Warren in the Nest, and I'll also be at the Tipsy Bear, which used to be the Checkers.
Right, on Preston Street.
On Preston Street, yeah. And I'll be there as well. So you just have to look out for the posters of the Wibbly Wobbly Dough.
And just one additional interesting factor about it, some of the shows are friendly for people with visual impairments.
Yeah, you have touch shows and also relaxed performances as well. That's at the Tipsy Bear.
Great. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Great.
No worries, thank you.
I've got a solution. Pizza! Terribly easy. Any dough will do. Very good. Two hands, okay? Ow!
Ow, don't do that, it hurts!
I'm so sorry. Oh. Did you hear that? You hurt her. You bully! Say sorry.
Sorry about that, Janet.
Oh, it's all right. I quite liked it, really.
Oh, that's understandable. I am the rolling pin.
Oh, you are. Would you roll me again?
Oh, yes, I'd love to.
Yeah, I'd love it too.
Oh, yes, that's my speciality.
Derek, roll me.
Janet?
Yeah.
It's traditional to lie down.
Oh, right, yeah.
Janet?
Yeah.
Is it your first time?
Yeah.
Oh, dear, I didn't bring any candles.
I don't care, just get on with it.
Oh, all right. Ooh, how's that?
Harder!
All right, Oh, you are a big girl.
Oh, Derek.
Oh, Janet.
Oh, Derek.
Janet.
Oh, Derek.
Janet.
Oh, Derek.
Oh, Janet, it's normally me that does the rolling.
Oh, Derek.
Oh, Janet. Janet, I better be going now. Thank you very much, but I've got some biscuits to roll out.
I thought I was the only one.
Oh, no. Oh, I'm a professional. Toodaloo!
That's the end of the show. Join us tomorrow and every night at 8:30 from the exciting Warren.
And we're at Brighton Fringe Festival here at the Warren. And if you're performing, be like the Beatles or Oasis or Michael Jackson. Don't worry about the critics, because you're no one until you've got 5,000 critics. Jade's going to see all the shows. Are you going to be critical or not?
I always have one critical eye, but generally I'm so enthusiastic and I'm so excited for all the performers. So one critical eye, one totally enthusiastic eye.
And when's our show on?
Every day, 8 p.m. Latest TV, woo!
I think it's 8:30, by the way.
I was going to say, yeah, 8:30. Turn in at 8 and get your snacks ready.
Goodbye.